Audiobook, Simply This Moment. 17 I Know You Mara, 1. 25th of August 2004. Almost a month of the rain's retreat has gone. When it comes to the opportunity for practice, it doesn't get any better than this. We should recall the opportunities that we haven't put everything we've got into the practice. Whatever duties you have to do, do them thoroughly, and when there's nothing to do, then do nothing. Sit in your hut or walk on your meditation path, and enjoy the freedom of having to do nothing. We have to go in the direction of working and meeting our responsibilities so often that sometimes we just aspire and long for the opportunity to practice in a monastery such as this, which is so well established, so well supported, and so well looked after. There's nothing much we have to do. So when you are in your hut and have this opportunity, make sure that you put great effort into doing nothing, controlling and wanting. Too many people still do things. You only have to look at the sutta we are going to chant next week, the Anuttalakkhana Sutta, SN 22.59, to see that each of these khandhas, aggregates, rupa, the body, vedana, the feelings, pleasure and pain, sanna, your perceptions, saskara, mental formations, your will, even vinaya, consciousness, is out of your control. There is no self in there that controls these things. The Buddha said in the Anuttalakkhana Sutta that if any of the khandhas were a self, you would be able to say, "Oh, may my consciousness be like this. Oh, may it not be like that. Oh, may my feelings be such. May my pleasure and pain not be like that." The Buddha said we cannot do that because there is no self, it is all anatta, non-self, and we do not control those things. It's a powerful statement. The Buddha said we should reflect upon the truth of anatta again and again. We may not personally have seen anatta, but at least we can have faith in the Buddha's teachings, clearly repeated so many times, that the five khandhas are nothing to do with us. They are out of our control. So why, when we meditate, do we try to control these things? Why do we try pushing and pulling the mind to be just as we want it to be, to get rid of this, and to get hold of that? Surely we should have got the message by now. It states in the suttas that the more one controls, the more one is going against the Buddha's advice. So our path of practice is to be able to sit down and learn what it means to be able to let go, to go in the opposite direction of the asava, the outflowings of the mind, and to just sit and be patient. The problem is that people don't know how to be truly patient. Whenever you are sitting down doing nothing, you want something. Craving and desire come up, and they take you away from this moment, and prevent you from going inwards. Remember, wanting is that force which takes you away from whatever you are experiencing now, into something in the future, into fantasies or dreams. According to the Sapurisa Sutta, the jhanas and enlightenment are always different from what you imagine them to be. Yena yena hi manandi tato tahati anatta, MN 113. So, how can you actually want anything, if you are not sure what it is that you want? We have the simile from the suttas of the person who has fallen in love with the most beautiful girl in the country, but he doesn't know what she looks like, or where she lives, what her name is, or even if she exists. Some monks, novices, and anagarikas in this monastery have already fallen in love with nimittas and jhanas, even when they don't know what they are, where they are, or whether they even exist or not. So why are you craving for something that you don't know? Leave all that alone. Let it go. Until there is no wanting at all, so that the mind is content, still, and peaceful. Your whole job in this meditation retreat is just to be peaceful, to be still. Make that your goal. Not jhanas, not nimittas, not enlightenment. Make it your goal to be as peaceful as you possibly can, to lessen those desires, to stop the mind moving and keeping the mind still to stop the mind being disturbed by you getting in control and wanting things. Remember that the greatest controller of all is Mara. Knowing Mara. Mara lives in the Paranimittavasvati realm. It is the realm where will, Satina, has power over others' creations, others' nimittas. It is almost like the realm of control freaks. Know that control freak within yourself. Understand that Mara is the doer inside you. He's always trying to push and pull you, saying, come on, don't get so sleepy. Come on, put forth some effort. Come on, get into a jhana. Come on, who do you think you are? Come on, how long have you been a monk? How long have you got left of your retreat? Come on, get going. That is Mara. In answer say, I know you Mara, and then Mara disappears. If you don't know Mara, if you don't know the control freak within you, then you will always get tense and frustrated. You can practice for years and years, and get very close to your goal, because Mara gives you a few crumbs every now and again. But you will never get a full meal. You will never get into the jhanas. Remember that the jhanas are the places that Mara can't go, where Mara is blindfolded. These are the places where Mara is banned. Why? Because anyone who has experienced a jhana knows that in those stages there is no control left, the potential to do is gone, and that potential to do is Mara. So, are you giving Mara an opportunity when you are meditating? Are you taking control, trying to steer this meditation, do it this way, do it that way? If you are, you will find that you don't get peaceful. I answered a question in the interviews by saying that we know we are going in the right direction if we relax, if it leads to peace, to a sense of freedom, to inner happiness. The Buddha's advice to Upali and Mahipajapati, the first bhikkhuni, was that if the training leads to things like dispassion and upasama, you know it is the Dhamma, the truth, the Vinaya. This beautiful word upasama means peace, quietness, stillness. When things settle down and there is no more business, that is upasama. You can understand what that really means, because when you are meditating, you experience that peace, that upasama sugha. The happiness of peace, just being still. There is nothing to do, and there are no burdens. You are resting not just the body, but also the mind. Then you know, this is the path, this is the Dhamma and the Vinaya of the Buddha. The Buddha made it very clear that what leads to peace is the Dhamma. So use that as a check to make sure you are going in the right direction. See how peaceful you can become. Don't just see how much you can crave and how much will power you can develop. Instead, see how much peace power you can develop. Giving up time. It sometimes happens, when you start with this way of peace, that you have to go through dullness. That's just old karma, bear with that. It will disappear, and when it disappears, you get energy. This beautiful energy is not the restless energy which comes from struggling and fighting, but a beautiful, peaceful energy. When you build up that peace, one of the great results is that you develop this fabulous mindfulness. What I am talking about is superpower mindfulness. One of the ways of developing superpower mindfulness is by what I call total listening. Whatever you are doing, you have to be totally there. Because listening is an important sense faculty, total listening is a great metaphor for this brilliant mindfulness. So whatever you are doing, you are totally listening to what's happening. Even when you are practicing present moment awareness meditation, you are totally there, totally listening, totally feeling. 100% of the mind is in the moment. When you understand the idea of what I mean by total listening, you also understand what this mindfulness is and how it becomes so powerful. When we Say total listening, we give it everything we've got, and then we find we have more to give to our mindfulness, to our alertness. We feel more deeply, we know more powerfully, and then mindfulness starts to grow and grow. It grows because we are not doing anything. The mind is still, it's not going away from total listening. When we look at the concept we call time, we see time only moves because of craving, because of doing things. When we stop doing things, when we stop planning, when we stop hurrying and hastening through the rounds of rebirth, time stops in this beautiful timelessness. Whenever we want something, we are already making the future. What is it going to be like? What is going to happen next? Where are we going to go next? And then we start going into ill will or guilt. We start looking into the past. It's all just craving or ill will. That's why I say the present moment is the place where you will be free from those things. Once craving and ill will stop, time stops, and then the idea of where we are going and what we are going to do next just disappears. The mind becomes still in time and we experience the beautiful timeless present. Those of you who get into deep meditation know what that feels like. Time has no meaning anymore. You sit there for hours and who cares? You don't really know. You don't have a clue that so many hours have gone past. Time has lost its meaning. And you are free from that burden. Mara is the entity inside the wristwatch, inside the clock, that is ticking. He's trying to control you. But when we go beyond time, then Mara gets very worried. He only goes to such places with difficulty. So remember, when you are meditating, when you are walking, whatever you are doing, to see if you can allow that peace, that stillness in time to develop. You don't know what day or hour it is, you just get up in the morning and meditate. Who cares what the time is? If you are tired, you can go back to bed again. Don't count how many hours you sleep, don't count how many hours you meditate, just get rid of that time business. In the Bhadrakarita Sutta, MN 131, it says, give up the past, give up the future. And the Dhammapada also says, give up the past, give up the future. When you have given up the past and the future, the next thing to give up is the present. Give up all time. If you can start to do that dash, giving up time fully, reflect on what it means. Use your insight practice to understand what timelessness truly is. Then you will understand how freeing that is. Straight away you get a perspective, a reflection that helps in your meditation, the reflection of timelessness, no time. So, when we are meditating, we can use these little words like timeless, no time, free of time, total listening, fully alert, fully aware in this very moment, as ways to remind ourselves, and to point the way in our meditation. Craving and ill will take us away from this moment. They take us away from where we are supposed to be going, which is inside of everything. If we keep being taken away from this moment, then we will never gain jhanas, and we will never get enlightened. We are always going somewhere else, never right inside. No one in here. Later in the retreat, we will start talking about the citadels of the self, the knower and the doer. They're right in the center of this. To get close to them is so difficult, because the doer is always pushing us away. The doer doesn't want to be seen for what it truly is, just a phantom, a fake. That's why it always pushes us away, so that we can't understand it or see it as it truly is. It is the same with the knower. It is so hard to see. But by stillness we get to understand what knowing and doing is. We have to find that place where nothing moves. We can't understand what it is. Timelessness is one of the places where you get the feeling that nothing is moving. It is upasama, peaceful. Stay there, don't do anything. Never ask yourself, what should I do next? You have lost the plot if you say that. What we are doing now? That is the only question. What we are doing now is to know more fully. Stay there. Be more patient. Give up wanting, give up trying to do things. Stop trying to change. The five khandhas, just leave them alone. Stop that process of Mara controlling and interfering. Say, Mara, I know you. When Mara scurries away, with head bowed. That is when Mara is known to the monk, novice, and agarika, layman, or the laywoman. Then Mara doesn't control. You are on the way to Nibbana, the cessation of all things. When this happens, you can see that things stop. Why do you always try to control these things? It is all impermanent, it rises and falls. Despite of you. If the world was under your control, you could actually control this. Business of impermanence, this night and day, things coming and going, happiness and pleasure, dark and light. How many times have you tried to control these things? All that happens is that it changes anyway. It is beyond you. So, anicca means uncertain, out of control, it come and goes as it wishes, without you being able to force it this way or that. That's why if you have a good meditation, fine. If you have a bad meditation, fine. Don't blame yourself. Don't become proud because you got a good meditation, thinking, now I can meditate. If any one of you have had a good meditation and think, now I can do it, the next meditation will be disappointing. You experience that many times because that's the nature of things. It is anicca, that's all, rising and falling, coming and going. So stop messing around. Allow it to be. Be content with the bad meditation, and be content with the good meditation. As my first meditation teacher said, there is no such thing as a bad meditation. There is just a meditation, it goes according to its causes and results. How can you control the results, when they depend on causes? It's just nature, that's all. It's nature doing its thing. You have to be part of this and let go. Enjoy the nature, the mind just unfolding. In fact, the more you let go and get out of the way of this process, the faster, more peaceful, and beautiful it becomes. The more you get out of the way, the more powerful is the path. You disappear. You are just being a nobody. Vanish into emptiness when you meditate, so that there's no one in there. You can do the perception of anicca-sanna. Anicca-sanna is the perception that no one is in here. What I mean by developing these perceptions is that when you are on the walking path, you start thinking about these things. You use your thoughts to focus your mind on what these things mean. At least you have enough knowledge and enough faith to know that there's nobody in here. The knower is no one. It is just a process of consciousness. When form hits the eye, there is a conjunction of these two, there's contact. With contact, there's a sense impression, that's all. When the mind object meets mind consciousness, the two come together, that's mind contact. From mind contact you get vedana. That's all it is. So when you understand what these things are, you see there's nobody in here. Even if you can't know that is true for yourself, because you have not seen it with wisdom yet, at least you've heard it with faith. Try it out. Imagine there are no other monks here. Imagine that things are just not there. Imagine that. Put yourself in that position, and then meditate from that perspective of non-self, seeing that as an imaginary place where you meditate. Start your meditation with that perception. Start your walking meditation with the thought that there's nobody else here. The Buddha said that the controller, the doer, the knower, is just a process, not a person, not a thing, not a being. So just walk, just sit, and see what happens. When you start with that perception of true Dhamma, It's amazing how easy it is to meditate. It's only because of delusion that meditation is hard. It's only because of not seeing things clearly or forgetting that you get frustrated and lost in your meditation. If you put that on it asana right in the beginning, as a perspective from where to start, then how can you fail in your meditation? There can be no failure at all, because there's no one to fail. So how can you even call it failure, or good meditation, or bad meditation? All this doing and measuring and controlling is cut off by that perspective. When you train yourself to look at your meditation, your walking meditation, your sleeping, eating, or whatever else you do, from that perspective, then you keep the perspective of nobody in here throughout the day, anatasana. When eating, it's just food going into the body, that's all. There's nobody tasting this food, just tastables. Tasted by the tongue, the two coming together and making contact. The contact generates a feeling, that's all it is. Keep those perspectives. Cold is just body feeling. When that body comes into contact with cold air, Vedana arises as a result. It's just the process, that's all. Big deal. Pain in the body is just body consciousness and body object coming together. There is contact and because of that there is feeling, that's all it is. Look at life like that. Look at each moment like that. Remember anatasana. It makes life so much easier when there is no one in here. And if you do that, anatta, 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 no self, no controller, no doer, no knower. Nothing in there, just emptiness, just a process. Imagine what would happen if you then sit down to watch the breath. It would be so easy to do, because there's no one doing it. Just the same, too often we get involved in something and we just mess it up. If we let the tree grow by itself, it grows very well. But if we start to mess around with it, pulling it this way, bending it that way, making it like this or that, we usually mess up. When we get involved with nature, we usually mess it up. Certainly that's the case with meditation. When we get involved in trying to do a little bit of controlling, it doesn't go well. If you try to watch the breath with control, the breath is never smooth. When you just leave the breath alone, when you are busy doing something else, then you don't control it at all and the breath is so smooth and natural. For many people, when they first start breath meditation, they start by watching the breath and they are controlling it at the same time. That's why it gets uncomfortable. They can't see themselves controlling. People have asked me, when I watch the breath, it's so hard and painful. When I don't watch the breath, it's nice and peaceful. What's going on? I tell them that when they are watching the breath, they are controlling it, because they've got into that habit. Whatever we watch, we get involved with, we control it as if it was ours. Whatever we feel is ours, whatever we sense is ours, we feel we have to do something about it, we have to control it. When you think, this is not mine, nothing to do with me, it is the same as the simile that the Buddha gave about the grass, sticks, and leaves in the Jada Grove, SN 35.101. Somebody collects them and burns them. Who cares? Because they do not belong to you, you don't care. It is the same with your meditation. Does your meditation belong to you? Does your mind belong to you? Does your Vedana, will or consciousness belong to you? Can't you look at your mind and the body like the grass and leaves outside? They don't belong to you. They are not yours. So, why are you striving so hard in this meditation? What are you doing? Who is doing it and why? When you actually look at it from the perspective of Dhamma, from anatasana, you can understand what your mistake is. You are controlling things. You are building up through striving and controlling this huge ego of a self. You become the meditator. You become the one who strives. You become the person who's putting all this effort into your meditation. When you do that, you find you get frustrated because you can see that Anuka is so uncertain. Whatever you want it to be, it becomes something else, something different. You just can't do it. You can't succeed in your meditation. You try for years and sometimes you get it right. But often you get it wrong. So, what are you doing wrong? You are doing, that's what's wrong. Leave it alone, don't do anything, disengage, detach, renounce, disengage, detach, renounce, disengage, detach, renounce, disengage,